On July 10th, 2013, Lawrence Lessig, along with several Massachusetts state representatives and a handful of Wolfpack volunteers, went to the Boston State House to explain how an Article 5 convention of the states can bring free and fair elections to America.
When the framers drafted the first draft of the Constitution, its provision for amending the Constitution said Congress had the power to propose amendments to the Constitution. And then an obvious question was raised. What if Congress is the problem? If Congress is the problem, we can't count on Congress to propose the reforms necessary to fix it. And this was an obvious problem, and the framers quickly changed the draft of the Constitution to include the essential backup to protect the liberty and the democracy which they were creating. And the essential backup was you. It was the state legislatures. Because what the framers did in Article 5 is they created a second path to amending the Constitution. And that path said that if state legislatures believe it's time to act outside of the ordinary process, they have the power to compel Congress to create an Article 5 convention. Now, I'm a law professor, so I'm going to quibble with the way people have spoken about this convention. This is not a constitutional convention. This is not the sort of convention that has the power to propose a constitution or to change the constitution. That's what we mean by a, quote, constitutional convention. The only thing an Article 5 convention can do is to propose an idea for how to fix a broken system, a system that has become corrupted, let's say, by a Congress that can't function. So I strongly support legislatures around the country creating the movement necessary to create this instance, this Article 5 convention, that could begin to give people who are not dependent upon the corruption of Washington an opportunity to think about how to fix this system. We have to recognize Uncle Sam has an addiction. He is a drunk. And what we have to organize is an intervention to give him a chance to once again legislate in a way that we can be proud of. The latest polls find 6% of America have confidence in Congress. 6%. I want to know who those people are. Because I have a bridge, I want to sell them. 6%. What we need is state legislatures to do their job. And their job is to stand up and organize the political force necessary to take on the essential corruption that means that our government cannot now function. And you here in Massachusetts can do that. Every single moment of important political change in the history of America began in Massachusetts. It was Massachusetts that began the Revolutionary War. It was Massachusetts that sent the essential people to Philadelphia to draft our Constitution. It was the abolitionists in Massachusetts that gave us the moral courage to take on slavery. It was Sumner who gave us the vision of what equality would mean. So too here. Massachusetts needs to lead this movement to save this republic from a corruption that is killing our government. Thank you.
I was just happy to be here and kind of experience the whole thing, and it gets you more excited to be involved. And plus, I was really in awe of some really good speakers, especially from our group. So that's
it. Do you think we're going to win?
Hell yeah. Can you say that there?
Yeah.
Quite frankly, in Washington, our political system is broken. Congress is dependent on its funders, not upon the people alone, as our founding fathers originally intended. In 2010, incumbent members of the House spent an average of $1.7 million on their re-election campaigns. In 1974, that figure was only $56,000. House members had to raise an average of $2,300 each and every day they were in office, holidays and weekends included, and spend half of their available time raising money. So the result is that Congress operates in a permanent campaign mode with little time for their constituents or for legislating. They're mired in partisan bickering and legislative gridlock. The Citizens United decision only made a deeply dysfunctional system worse.
And then I got into this for a couple reasons. I mean, obviously, Cenk told me about getting it started, but I knew about the progressive movement in the early 20th century, and which seemed like we were kind of replaying the Gilded Age nonsense of the 19th century, so I figured this had to happen eventually. So seeing somebody else starting it, I figured this has to be the important political movement.
What is important is us as Americans. It transcends liberal and conservative. We may have different ideas about what's best for our country, but at the end of the day, we all want what's best for our country. And to be honest, this is something that I've only recently become involved with actively, because I'm almost embarrassed to say it, but I fell into despair when I first came to this realization. I thought, this is too big, there's nothing we can really do. But then I realized that our country and the people within it have fixed bigger problems in the past. I mean, we started off with a ragtag group of colonists taking on the biggest military empire in the world. Getting a bunch of state legislatures to pass a resolution like this one doesn't seem so hard in comparison. And it, in a sense, we really owe it to previous generations to do all that we can in order to fix this problem. Because our country is built on the principle of continually making it better. That's why we have the ability to amend our Constitution.
I think that the testimony I heard today, makes me feel pretty hopeful. A lot of good arguments were made, and I don't know, my state legislators personally, but I would have to imagine that they'd have to take, that into account, and I don't think they can, just dismiss that. I think that today was a really good day.
We, as you recall, passed a resolution last year out of the General Court calling on Congress to act with regards to the Citizens United decision. They have taken no action. The Disclose Act, which is a very reasonable response in terms of actually making sure that the funds that are going into our elections are disclosed, has not passed Congress. So we've seen no action from the Congress. The only other avenue left to the people is to call for a constitutional convention. This is provided to us by Article 5 of the United States Constitution. It hasn't happened in the nation's history, although many states have in the past actually done what we're asking the committee to vote favorably on, which is to call for a convention. And we are hopeful that this time will be different and that we will rise to this occasion. So we ask the committee to consider this carefully, to join what we hope will be ultimately enough states in calling for a constitutional convention to come up with a solution to address the problem of money in politics.
There's not a more important thing you can do as a state legislator right now than to take action to fix the way that our government operates, because everybody gets on some level that money is influencing our politicians and they're no longer representing us, right? I think everybody gets that to some degree. I don't think there's many people in this room that would disagree with that. And as Professor Lessig was saying earlier, our founding fathers were pretty smart people, and they gave us this avenue to take if our federal government ever became unresponsive to us, the people, right? So welcome to 2013, right? That's where we are. Our federal government is completely unresponsive to us. That's demonstrated almost on a daily basis. Within the last couple months, you can take almost any piece of legislation. Just the most glaring one is probably the background checks. 90% of Americans want that. That's just a common sense law, and Congress couldn't do it, right? They couldn't pass the most common sense thing that we agree with. So it's broken. The system is just broken. But thankfully, they did have the foresight to give us this other avenue to amend our Constitution. They told us to come to you guys. They said, go to your state legislators, get them to call an Article 5 convention, and let's fix this on the state level. And that's what we have to do.
The main point is that just because people have more money and are able to contribute to their campaign shouldn't mean that you listen to them more. And unfortunately, I feel like that's what's happening in our country. There has to be an equal playing field where our representatives fully represent us with no other considerations in their minds.
The point I'm trying to get across is that when I make a significant contribution to a campaign, I'm no longer just another constituent you're representing. I become something more important than another constituent. That's not fair to everyone else. My political agenda and ideas are heard more loudly and taken more seriously. That's not just, especially considering the class of people who donate money to campaigns have significantly more wealth and different priorities than the other 98% who don't. This system is letting a very small group of funders have such a disproportionate influence over the laws that affect everyone. Just the fact that their influence is disproportional strays away from the spirit of a representative democracy.
I'm here to participate in government. For the first time, I showed up at a hearing to hear testimony on money and politics.
Nice. So how did it go? What do you think?
I think it went very well.
You made our case?
I think we did. I think everyone that testified did a very articulate job in expressing the issue, the solution to the issue, and the impact.
Nice. And how did you find out about Wolfpack anyway?
I heard an interview you did on Coffee Party USA Radio, and I was very struck by the way you spoke with the passion you have for this issue, and it made me feel happy for the first time that there was a positive step I could take by helping a grassroots effort to address this.
The fact that the institutions we have developed give people these perverse incentives to grab for themselves at the expense of our whole country is a large problem. The framers of our Constitution understood this. When Hamilton gave a speech which was put in the Federalist Papers, he mentioned that the Article 5 Convention was a tool in which the states could stop overreaching and corruption at the national level.
About the legislative process, and I believe in state government. I believe that state government is one of the most responsive and important tools of government that the people have to really exert their will about the society that we construct together. After that, I went on the road, though, and I went on the campaign trail, and I was a guy who sat in a room with people 5 to 7 hours a day and called rich people and begged them for money so that they could go to Congress. And if you're running for Congress today, or if you want to run for Congress someday, you're going to spend 50% to 70% of your time raising money on a phone. And the things you have to say are not the things you want to say. They're the things that you have to say to get the money. And I've sat in that room and seen that conversion that takes place, the corruption that takes place. Because the definition of a corrupt system is not one where everybody's bad. The definition of a corrupt system is one where good people make bad decisions thinking that it's normal. And I think we see that a lot today, especially at the level of our federal politics. I will also give you a warning. After I worked on the campaign trail, I worked in advertising, political advertising. We laid out millions of dollars of checks every weekend and sent them to television stations in the mail. And what I saw when Citizens United happened in 2010 was a distinct difference than what had come before. There were races where 98% of the money for paid media, for communications, television, and radio and cable came from outside independent expenditures. They did not come from the party. They did not even come from the candidate. But 98% of million-dollar budgets were coming from somebody that could write a check in 2 minutes, and that could take away all the work that that person had done in 2 years to raise that money, spending 5 to 7 hours a day, 6 days a week raising that. Somebody could sit there in 2 minutes and counteract all that hard work like that. And what that is not democracy anymore, right? And that's a handful of people throughout this country. And Jefferson said it best. He said, you know, the same is true today as it's been throughout history, whether men will be allowed to rule themselves or be governed by a small elite. And when people are dependent upon that small group of people for that money, we're ruled by a small elite. But I believe in self-government. I believe in self-determination. And this change starts with you here today in Massachusetts, a place where Lessig said great changes started before. The abolition movement, you know, the founding of our country started with people just like you. And I want you to think with that vision and how much they gave up to change the constructs of our society, to change the way that our government is written, because we must amend the Constitution and fix this problem if we are still to have representative government in this country. Thank you for your time.
So what's the one thing you learned today? What do you think that was the one thing you learned today by being here?
Well, I mean, I think that people underestimate the power of their voice and, you know, and power in numbers. So hopefully more people that see this and get involved will, you know, make the movement better for us. So.